On? Is it on? Ah! Hi! Hello? Hello? Yeah, I am on. Okay, good morning, everyone. hey, I just wanted to get up here and introduce this Sunday before the band starts playing. For anyone who's here who doesn't know who I am, my name is Brianne Steindl, and I am the youth leader here at Christ Wesleyan Church. And this Sunday is Youth Sunday. Yeah. So the youth are running the service this morning. So that's why we have our youth band up here. They're awesome. They're going to play some worship music for us this morning. And before they play their first song, I needed to announce these little welcome bags for visitors. They told me I'm not allowed to pretend to be a visitor so I can eat the cookies. So if you're a visitor and you get a welcome bag and you don't want your cookies, see me after the service. They are located right back here in the back. So if you're a visitor, grab one. And if you guys want to take a couple minutes and high-five everyone around you, say good morning, then our band's going to jump into our first worship song. Thank you.
For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of His will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please Him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God.
Let's pray. Lord God, Holy Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning, this opportunity to be here and worship you. I pray that as we take the offering this morning, the money we collect, Lord, you will use to glorify your kingdom and to further your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Who the sun sets free. All is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me.
Any? Matt Baldwin, what is your favorite color?
Purple.
Yellow.
Red.
Blue.
Red? My favorite color is blue.
Wrong.
So not fair.
You fail!
Failure! That's my middle name.
It is, yeah, definitely wrong. It's a bunch of youth that go to a group to learn about the Bible, and they're all youths. And it's a group.
It's a lot of fun. We get to have worship and a really cool sermon and usually a fun game if you're into games.
And you have the best youth leader ever.
Best, yeah.
Youth group would be a place where we can all come together and keep each other safe, I guess. We can confide in each other and help each other grow spiritually.
And it's like a giant family where you can just feel loved and wanted and learn about God with other people your age.
It's probably between like the games that we play or something, just because it somehow always ends up being like Gabe or Andrew trying to show off.
Matthew and Jane, they got like candy and other like different stuff, like gift cards or whatever, like taped onto them. And then they like had a little bit of a head start, and then all the rest of the youth started running after them like human pinatas. And then I think it was Jane, or was it you, Matthew, that climbed a tree?
I thought it was Jane.
Climbed a tree to get away, and then he was forced to get down, and they were just all running about. All I watched in a game.
Probably played laser tag at the walk-in, even though we had to wait for it in that line, but.
One time at a walk-in, this is probably like 4 a.m., decided that I was gonna carry Emily on my back and run, see how fast I could go. So I was telling myself I could do it, so I was yelling out, like, I can do it, and I just face planted right in the middle of the gym with Emily on top of me.
The lock-in?
The lock-in was pretty fun.
That's the only thing I could think of.
Well, there was also, I can't remember if it was this year, but the Dixie Classic Fair. It wasn't this year, but last.
I don't remember it. Oh, now I remember it! I remember it now! I don't know how I forgot that, because I had to take that picture.
I remember at camp 2 years ago. Gabe was trying to jump over a fence and he slipped and hit his ankle and almost died. And then he started hyperventilating, or what I thought was hyperventilating, but he was really just laughing. And that was a funny memory because I thought Gabe was going to die.
And this year, I tried to jump a fence and I hit my shin and I flipped on the ground. So actually, now that I say I've grown in the past year, I don't think I have. I'm becoming more like Gabe, so I've digressed in the past year.
There was a competition at the walk-in, since it was St. Patrick's Day, who could wear the most green. So I remember dressed head to toe in green. And you just wore a t-shirt, though.
I wore a t-shirt, some cool glasses.
Yeah, I wore a green shirt, a green coat. I went all...
I know you
not all out of some people, but...
Like Abby, who dyed her hair green?
Yeah.
How positive they are?
I like how we get to overhead and sing songs and talk about Jesus.
Just like everybody's like friends with each other, you know, nice to each other and stuff, and like you can like tell people stuff.
I get to have fun with the people that I love and that care for me and that are always there. And the fact that we always have people that look out for each other.
Hanging out with some of the people. Because some of them are called in there is Cave.
Thinking.
You do that.
I think at least one of them would being able to fellowship with other
Christians as well.
I'll steal his answer.
I can't steal answers. It's called cheating.
I like how we're all together. And like, we actually talk to each other. We're all open. I like how everyone's like welcoming. Because of my past church, everyone's like, they already had their cliques and stuff. And you guys are just really welcoming. And this feels like a family here.
I like how we can be real with each other and really get to know God in different ways than I would have thought of originally. I really like when we do the smaller groups after we do the messages, where we have like prayer time, I guess, with each other individually, so you get to like really open up about stuff in school.
My favorite thing about youth group is the fact that everybody's like, I haven't been in the youth group very long, and I just feel like I know everybody. Like, everybody, nobody's left out or anything. Everybody's together, and it's like a really big family.
I mean, it's a great time to hang out with a lot of people throughout the week, but that's not the most important part. The most important part of me being there is the messages that are shared. Brienne does a lot of great in-depth messages with us. So being there for that kind of stuff, because we talk about a lot of stuff that you can apply to your everyday life and through your week and stuff. So going and getting that is kind of like a guide for the rest of my week sometimes. If we're talking about a certain subject and I can notice that, then I can strive throughout the next week and time to put that in practice in my life. I don't know where I'm going after that, but yeah, that part is the most important and best part.
Like, makes me a better person and doesn't let me ponder the influence of what other teenagers do.
I feel like whenever like we're out in the real world and we see like a problem, I feel like we have a better way of handling it and better decision making.
It has made me a better person, honestly, because before I like always felt like I didn't have my life full, and now I feel like since I've known Jesus, like everything's come together.
That's awesome.
If you want people to be more nicer, don't talk about them, and if you don't like them, just keep it to yourself. Don't talk to other people about it; it makes it worse. And then he also said, if you want this like community to get better, then like don't talk about your presidents, don't talk about like special leaders, even if you don't like them. Just don't talk about them. Just keep it to yourself, because then it makes it even worse. And it was like really good sermon.
But you know, like the lesson that like Irish guy or whatever, when he was talking about like historical accuracy of the Bible and different stuff. That's just good, like, saying how, like, there's more accounts of that than there is of, like, a lot of, like, famous historical people, and people just automatically, like, kind of believe that, so, that's really good.
Well, I always thought that I had no skills in anything, like, so I would never try anything new. And then when I started playing in the youth band, I found, oh, I don't totally suck at drumming.
Probably that one with the video that, like, explained the, like, the historical proof of a lot of the stuff that happened in the Bible, because that was neat.
I like when you did the songs. I think that was, like, based on something, like, we could all connect to, because we all listen to stuff, and I think people listen to music a way for, like, them to explain themselves. And, like, going through the songs helped, like, I don't know how to say it. It's just the songs, like, breaking them down, figuring out how the artists felt in that moment.
I really liked, like, when he was talking about where, like, he said, like, what's true about you isn't really the truth about you, because that was, like, wow, that's really actually an awesome thought. Like, I don't know, I just thought that was really cool.
I have a lot of issues with following commands because I'm like this edgy teenager. I'm so rebellious. I go to bed at 9:30. I don't like to follow orders, and I'm like, just, you know, if it's not what I want to hear, then I don't want to hear it. And he was like, it really spoke to me because God puts those people in your life for a reason.
The one that I remember the most is when Joel showed us the video about the, like, the stars. You remember, like, with the, how he did the, like, the earth and then, like, the sun and then all the bigger things and, like, how small we are in the universe, but still, like, how much God cares about us. That lesson stuck with me a lot, and that was a cool one. So that lesson with Joel on Sunday night. The message where at the end, the night, I don't know if, yeah, it was a normal one, but the night message where we all went up and we wrote, like, he had the on the board. Hold on, I'm running out of breath. He had on the board, I need Jesus, and then we, like, all wrote our names. He was talking about, and I shared this in the group time, but he was talking about, like, not caring what other people think, especially, like, about your spiritual faith, and that always stuck with me, because that's something I did a lot, and I'm striving now not to do. Because I felt a lot of pressure, and, like, not even that other people gave me, just, like, I felt like for some reason everyone was watching everything I did, and I had that anxiety about, like, my spiritual faith when nobody's really watching, and it only matters, like, God's, what God sees of you, because he sees everything, and he sees your heart, so that's what matters, and that message, that was probably the biggest thing that stuck with me through camp, and actually probably the past couple of years. That is, like, the biggest thing, is that, because I've done it my whole life, and it's, like, it doesn't matter what other people think, especially about your spiritual faith, because it's, like, a friendship with someone else, doesn't matter what other people think about that, it matters between you two, so.
I think I've, like, gotten closer, like, because since, like, I used to go to, like, a Christian school, and I go to, like, a public school, I just got to, like, meet, like, different people, and it just got me to, like, show them God more, I guess. And you can still show, like, God to, obviously, people that are in Christian schools, but, like, to people that are, like, might not even have, like, any kind of experience, like, with God, or, like, the only people that they've met, really, that were, like, godly people, like, really weren't. So it just got me to, like, just talk to different people.
Since I've started, probably freshman year, but since I've started being in Joel's youth group, or not youth group, small group, and then coming to youth group and stuff, I feel like I've grown a lot more. Being here more, being able to be here more because I do less with school, and then being in Joel's small group has helped a lot me grow. So, yeah, I really feel like past while I've grown in my faith a lot.
A manatee, because all they do is float around the ocean and eat.
You know, I'd probably be a dead bear, because it's not alive anymore.
Sure.
I think of a really, like, ironic animal. Like, it sounds really dumb, but it's actually really useful.
You'd be a sloth.
Oh, no, I'd want to be a honeybee, or a bumblebee, because they defy the laws of physics. kind of like me. Like, how did they get this ugly? But that's still self-deprecating.
So. I'd probably be a sugar glider?
Oh, yeah.
Those suckers are mean.
I'd rather be a dolphin. Aren't dolphins smarter than humans, or is that a myth?
I don't think that's true.
Well, if dolphins are smarter than humans, I want to be a dolphin.
Definitely not.
Okay, we're good.
All right, great.
Video is just a couple of the lovely faces of Christ Wesleyan Youth Group, and I thought it'd be a good way. Yeah, I thought it'd be a good way for everyone to get to know the youth a little bit better. And hey, if you want to like get to know some of these kids better, take them to get food, take them out for coffee. They'd be all for it. Yes, I just heard one of them shout, "I like food." They're all in the back raising their hands. I just wanted to touch on a couple of things from the video real quick. One of the questions that we asked the youth was, what's one of the things you really feel like you've learned this past year, or one of the lessons that we've done in youth group that have really stood out to you? A couple of them said the thing with the worship songs. To expand on that a little bit, we have been, the series that we're doing right now in youth actually is taking worship songs that we sing and breaking them apart and taking the lyrics and trying to understand what the lyrics really mean and trying not to just feel the emotions over the songs, but also to understand the words and pursue a balance of worshiping with the emotions and the understanding of the song. And then a couple of the youth said, I like that video series with the Irish guy who talked about the history of the Bible. Well, we previously to this had done a video series that was basically apologetics for youth. It really was all about equipping the youth with the ability to explore why they believe what they believe. So I just wanted to clarify on those things and let you guys know a little bit what we're doing with the youth. And I also, another thing I wanted to say this morning was that I really always encourage the youth to be open and honest and transparent and genuine. So as I always say to the youth, in the spirit of being open and honest and transparent, I'm a little bit nervous this morning. Thanks. But I also encourage the youth to really step out of their comfort zone. Oh, and you know what I want to say? I'm so proud of the youth band. They are awesome. You know, speaking of stepping out of your comfort zone, I think they've only just started the band. I think they really only played on Wednesday night 3 or 4 times. So this is like their fifth gig up here, you know? Some of them have just started learning how to play instruments, and they're killing it. They're doing incredible. So I always encourage them to step out of their comfort zone. And when I was asked to do this morning, I thought, what kind of leader would I be if I wasn't willing to do the very thing I was encouraging the youth to do? So here I am. A Okay, so let's hop right into our message this morning. We're going to be looking at Proverbs 3:13. And it says, "Blessed are those who find wisdom, those who gain understanding." And I really want to pull two words from that verse to focus on a little bit, which are wisdom and understanding. And I kind of want to break those down and talk about the differences between them. And I think if we're going to do that, we also need to add in a third component, which is knowledge. So I want to go through and look at the differences between knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. And I think if we boil it down as simply as we can call knowledge facts. We can call understanding the ability to translate meaning from the facts. And we can call wisdom the ability to discern and apply the knowledge. And for those of us who are visual learners like myself, I found this nifty chart on the internet that I think is going to be up on the screen. Yeah, this really helps me to look at this. So it breaks down knowledge and understanding and wisdom even more into facts, meaning, what to do next, information, principles, application, memory, reason, action. And I thought this was an interesting thing too, is comparing it to scholars, teachers, and practitioners. I had to flip back to my notes. I pulled up the chart. I want to take these three things and apply them to an example. So I thought we might would use fire, because fire is fun, right? So if we apply this to the example of fire, knowledge could be that I know that this fire is hot. I know that it takes oxygen and some sort of fuel to burn. I understand, you know, I understand how to apply the knowledge to making the fire. If the wood is wet, the fire's probably not going to burn very well. If there's too much wind, you know, the fire might get blown out. It might not start. Then I have the wisdom not to give the fire to the youth. but really, I know how to apply it to different circumstances in life. When I'm cold, I know how to use it to keep warm. You know, you can use it to cook, and you can use it to entertain. Oh! I really wanted to see what Pastor Mark was going to do when I did that, because he had no idea that I was going to do that. And he's just over here like, cold, like, oh no, what is happening? Yeah, so maybe a more in-depth and personal, like I want to go through a couple of different examples of how to apply these three principles and kind of what it looks like. So I think a more in-depth and personal example of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding being applied is for myself. I've always grown up in church being told that God is good. And I remember we used to use that phrase, they say, God is good.
All the time.
Yes, all the time.
God is good.
Yes, I wasn't sure which one I was going to get, because I know there are two different ones, or it's like, God is good, God is great, or something like that. Yeah, so I wasn't sure if I was going to get left hanging or not, but I remember doing that all the time.
God is good.
Yeah. And I remember, you know, in children's church, you pray that prayer that says, God is good, God is great, let us thank him for this food. So I don't think I ever really wondered whether it was the truth or not. But I don't think I had much of an understanding of God's goodness. I think I only really knew it as a fact. But a little over a year ago, I went through something really hard, which was my best friend committing suicide. And a lot of you probably you remember her because she came to church here a lot with me when I was younger. Her name was Elise. And I just remember right after she passed, in church, singing the song that's like, "You are good, good, oh, oh." And I remember just thinking to myself, how can I sing those words right now? How can I say, "God, you are good," when I just lost my best friend? And I think that was the point when I started to question that and really pursue the understanding. I think that was the point where I actually started to understand just how good God really is and why he is good. God never had to put Elise in my life in the first place. He never had to bless me with 15 years of friendship that we had. And instead of looking at the situation as, "God, how could you let my friend be taken away?" I think I started to see it more as a thank you for letting me have her in my life. And giving me that time that I had with her. And regardless of all that, Jesus still died for me. My viewpoint totally changed from, "God, how can I say that you are good right now?" to, "God, how could I not praise you for how good you are?" And I think that I also gained a lot of wisdom from the situation, too. I'm able to walk through painful situations with my friends in a way that I never could have before. I'm able to use the story to talk to people about suicide and to encourage people to really value their friendships. I thought about what the pastor said a few weeks ago, where he talked about how you had to break a glow stick for it to glow. I think from so much brokenness and so much pain in my life, I've seen a lot of light and good and gained a lot of wisdom. There's a part that I'm going to skip over. I'm going to skip it, if that's okay with you guys. So if you're confused by your notes in the bulletin, ask me about it later. I just don't feel like it fits in as well as I thought it did. I want to go through a biblical story and apply these principles to the story of David and Bathsheba. And I really wish I had a flannel graph. The youth are probably like, "What is a flannel graph?" Well, guys, a flannel graph is a felt board. It's a little board. I'd set it up here, and I had little characters, little felt characters I could stick on it, and I could move them around and tell the story. It's kind of like almost like a puppet show. It's real cool. Oh, side note, if anyone in here has a flannel graph, I would love to borrow it for the youth sometime. Anyway, I digress. So, I'm going to give a really short kind of just an overview of the story of David and Bathsheba. Because we don't have time to read the whole thing. There are so many more details to this story. If you want to know more, I super encourage you to go read it. So, the bare bones of it, the basics are, David sees this babe out on a roof, right? Taking a bath. And one thing leads to another, and Bathsheba ends up pregnant with David's child. David's like, "Oh no, I messed up. I got this married woman pregnant. How am I gonna fix this?" So he puts her husband in the front lines of battle, where the husband gets killed. Then David takes Bathsheba as his wife. Then God sends the prophet Nathan to say, "Hey, David, God's not really okay with you, what you did. He doesn't think that was cool, and the child's going to die." God does forgive David, but the child does still pass away. Now, if you want to continue with the story, you can fast forward about 20 plus years, and in enters another character. I'd put another character on the flannel graph. His name is Absalom, who is David's son. And David's son Absalom actually rebels against David and tries to take over his kingdom. And there's another guy named Ahithophel. And Ahithophel is David's wise counselor. And he tells King David, he advises him and tries to give him advice. And actually Ahithophel, David's counselor, follows the son, Absalom, and tries to help him take over David's kingdom. In the end, they end up being unsuccessful. Absalom dies. Ahithophel hangs himself. So they did not take over the kingdom. But I think a question here is, why would Ahithophel, David's right-hand man, you know, kind of his counselor, why would he turn against David? I think it's revenge. Because Ahithophel was actually Bathsheba's grandfather. So if you look at the story, David had the knowledge of the law of Moses. He had that knowledge. He knew what was right and wrong. He had the understanding of what the laws meant. He had the understanding of how he should have treated Bathsheba. However, he didn't apply godly wisdom in this case. He followed his own desires. And I think we can see the consequences of his choices since he didn't choose to apply God's wisdom to this circumstance. And even though God forgave him, he still had to live with the consequences. And I think that sometimes in our lives, we have to live with those consequences when we choose not to apply godly wisdom to our lives. And there is one more point I kind of want to touch on before we have our band come back up. I'll tell you guys when to come back up. Hold on. Side note, put a pin in that. Because this is going to be a couple more minutes. I think one of the things I wanted to end with was, how can we seek out wisdom? And I think there are kind of three big points I came up with about seeking wisdom. And I pulled a scripture verse to go along with each one, so I'm just going to read those. I think we can seek wisdom through prayer. James 1:5-6 says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind." I think another way that we can seek wisdom is through reading our Bible. And I pulled 2 Timothy 3:14-15 that says, this is God, you know, talking to Timothy. Or I don't think I said that right. Did I say that right? God speaking through Paul. Yes, correct. So I was kind of right. Just making sure. Okay, so anyway, 2 Timothy 3:14-15 says, "But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have been given the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Jesus Christ." And then the last one, one of the last ways I think that's important in seeking wisdom is seeking out wise counsel. I think it's important for us to go to other people that God's put in our lives and ask them for advice. And I pulled Proverbs 12:15 that says, "The way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he who heeds counsel is wise." And that, I feel like that was kind of short, but that's okay. It was short and simple. And I'm going to make a closing statement, but I'd like our band to come back up and start getting ready for their closing song, if that's cool with you guys. Yep, they're heading up here. So with the youth, I always try to leave them with some sort of challenge or way that they can apply what we've talked about to their lives. And in Proverbs chapter 3, it goes on after verse 13 to talk about how valuable wisdom is. It says that it's more valuable than gold, it's more valuable than rubies, and nothing that we desire can compare to it. And I think a way that we can maybe apply what we talked about today is really trying to value wisdom and treat wisdom like it is that valuable, like it's more valuable than anything we can desire. And I don't think I always do it right by any means. And even David, who was said to be a man after God's own heart, he didn't always do it right, you know? But I really want to pursue knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. And I wanted to challenge everyone else to pursue it with me as well. And I'm going to pray for us before our band sings our last song. God, thank you so much for this time that we've had to gather together. Thank you so much for these awesome youth and the way that you're using them and the gifts that you're blessing them with and the opportunities to use them. Please help us all to continue to grow in more knowledge, more understanding, and more wisdom of you, and let us apply those things to our lives. And just thank you for this time that we've had this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good, good Father. You're a good, good father. Sing it in. Who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. One more time. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. See, I stole that line that you are loved from that song right there, because you are. And if I can just challenge you this morning, what an incredible, simple, and Bree, just so you know, there's no such thing as a bad short sermon. People love them. They love them. But at the you know, risk of re-preaching what she said, I'll add one little thing. You know, there's an 18-inch difference between knowledge and understanding and wisdom. It's the distance between here and here. And I think we could all stand to grow about 18 inches. And I don't know about you. I woke up this morning and I was just, I thought something incredibly dynamic is going to happen today. And we've gotten to experience it. I'm so stinking proud of you guys. I'm serious. Yes, I'm so proud of you. Because if you don't think it takes courage to get up here, then we invite whoever you are to come be the worship leader next weekend. In fact, you can preach. I'll take another week off too. Now, I'm so proud of you guys, Bree. Incredibly dynamic, awesome word. And I hope that, you know, her description of the shortness of it or the simplicity of it, that's the best kind. We don't need something that's so profound that we go, We need something to think about, and you gave us that. Thank you. And thank you for not setting the sanctuary on fire. But you got to show me how to do that. That was pretty cool. Just a couple of announcements before we dismiss this morning. But very important ones. You know, all these youth that now that Bree gets to take care of and instruct and lead, they all got started in children's ministry. And our children's ministry is, if you haven't noticed, is growing by leaps and bounds. Praise be to God. And next weekend, next Sunday night, we're going to kick off our Vacation Bible School. Now, we got a little late start in planning and all that, but it doesn't matter because I want you to know a couple of things. Taya still needs some volunteers. She needs a teacher for one particular class. I'm sure if you're willing to help, she can use you in any way. I've been gone, so Taya, where are you, by the way? Are you in here? There you are. Everybody knows who Taya is, but see her this morning. Even if you can only do something super small, please let her know, because it's going to be incredible next weekend. It runs Sunday through Wednesday night, 6 to 8:30 each night. Yes, ma'am? Okay, so meet in the searcher's classroom right after this if you can help in any way, because it's going to be phenomenal. And then, in the spirit of all these awesome people behind me, the second weekend of August, Andrea is going to be leading a workshop, a worship and music workshop for any youth that are interested. It's not just for these folks, but it's anybody. If you have an interest, a talent, a desire, if you can play a foghorn, come to her class. It's going to be incredible. But it's on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday morning. Is that correct? That second weekend, Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday morning. So the information is in the bulletin, but please, it's going to be awesome. She's been planning this a long time, and it's going to be phenomenal. Lastly, next weekend we conclude this series on Proverbs. I hope that you've been benefiting as much as I have from the devotions and Proverbs. If you haven't or you still want to sign up for that, feel free to just send us an email giving us your email, and we'll get you added to the list. And then last but not least, 2 weeks from today, 2 weeks from today is going to be the Hoover Walk. And I know that Mr. Hunt made an announcement last weekend, but just so we kind of get this bug in your ear, 2 weeks from today, our life groups that meet on Sunday mornings, some of them may still meet, but our worship service is going to be at the park. Our whole deal, they probably announced that last weekend while we were away, but our whole worship service is going to be there. Joanne Lyon's going to be here. We're going to have activities for the kids. In fact, the Vacation Bible School superhero theme is going to conclude at the park that day. So we'll have stuff for the kids to do if some of us adults want to walk. Or I think I want to play with the kids, Taya, so don't make me, leave me out. But sincerely, it's just awesome stuff happening, even though it's summer and trips and vacations and people, missing every weekend. But it's still awesome that God's word is being proclaimed here. God's praises are being lifted up, and we are seeing lives changed. So last but not least, remember, I am loved, and remember, you are loved. God bless you guys. Have a great week. Thanks for being here. Stop. Feels like it's never gonna. Got it.